The Torah tells us in Chaya Sarah, chapter Chaf Dalet 24, Pasuk 60, Samach, Vayivarachu es Rivka. And from here, from the Pasuk of Vayivarachu es Rivka, Chazal deduce the concept of Birkas Erisin, the concept of making a bracha by the kiddushin, by the wedding ceremony. In halacha, there are two concepts: there's kiddushin, and there's nisuin. Today, what we call engaged is meaningless in terms of halachic status. Like, you don't need a divorce if you break an engagement. But midin ha-gemara, once someone did kiddushin, even though we call it an engagement, it's much more than that. If you get kiddushin, then you need a get. So either way, so this halacha we know at the today bizman hazeh, it's not really an issue. We do it all together. We do the kiddushin and the suin bevas achas. We do it under the chuppah. Usually the rabbi makes the birkas erisin, and then we need a break, so we do the we read the ksuva, etc. But we do So they point out that when do we actually make this Birkas Erisin? So the Rambam writes, Kol ha-mitzvah zivarach over lasiyason. The Rambam writes that all mitzvahs should make over lasiyason, and that's his, in Hilchas Brachas, that's the general rule. And in Hilchas Ishas, Paragimel, Lachachav Gimel, he spells it out quite clearly. Shetzarach levarach kodem hakedushin. You have to make a bracha before kedushin. Kederach shemavarchin. Kederach shemavarchin al kol hamitzvus. You have to make a bracha on kedushin, just like you do on all other mitzvahs. Vim kiddush. And if you made kedushin velo beirach. And if you made kiddushin and you didn't obey rakodim, lo yivarach achakach. And the Rambam tells us the rule that birkas erisin is no different than all birkas hamitzvah. We always make a bracha first, then we do the mitzvah. And so too by birkas erisin, before the chasen says areya mikudeshesli to the kala and gives the ring, you make the bracha first. And that's it. And the Rambam writes, if you did the kiddushin and you forgot to make the bracha, so he writes, "Lo yivarach achakach." He says it's too late, so you're still married. You did the kiddushin, but you lose that on the bracha. This is a general machlokas among the Rishonim, the Rambam versus the Or Zeruah in Hilchas Shechita. When, let's say, you already slaughtered the animal and you realize you didn't make a bracha, that gets into whether Shechita is different or not, whether Shechita is a Birkas HaMitzvah, Birkas HaShevach, but what have you? You have a machlokes, the Rambam and the Or Zeruah, whether you can make the bracha afterwards. The Rambam says no, so consistent with his view here, and the Or Zeruah says yes. Well, halacha we make a compromise. It depends on the nature of the mitzvah. If it's a continuous mitzvah, so then the mitzvah is still going on. So then we do make a bracha. You have other issues, but. That's the machlokes, the Rambam and the Or Zeruah. So here the Rambam spells it out clearly: before the mitzvah of kedushin, you make a bracha, and after, it's too late. However, Tosis writes in Sukkim in the name of Rabbeinu Tam, and derive it on the spot. He disagrees with the Rambam, and he says, "Anu ein nohagin kein." That is not our practice. Elo makadesh va'achakach mevarach. No, first you do the kiddushin, then you make the bracha. So it seems to be a machlokas Rambam and Ravid, whether you make the bracha before the kiddushin or after. And in fact, there's a shitas harash in Ksuvis that discusses the nature of the bracha. You expect the mitzvah of the kiddushin to be asher kiddushano, the mitzvos of Bitsivanu al mitzvah kedushin or lakadosh es ha'isha. But by birkas erusin, it doesn't have the typical bracha. It's a different language. That not in the classical. It says baruch atah Hashem. Okay, first you make the baruch for Yagafen, then you say the classical baruch melech olam. Asher kedeshetal b'mitzosa b'tzivano al harayas. You command me regarding forbidden relations. Va'asa lono es arusos. And you forbade someone who's betrothed upon us. V'ita lono es anesuas. You permitted someone who did nesuin. Lono ayidei chupa v'kedushin. Baruch atah Hashem. V'kadesh amal yitzal yidei chupa v'kedushin. So the Rush is bothered by this strange language. It's not the classical Birkas HaMitzvah. And therefore, the Rush says the Bracha is very telling about the nature of the Mitzvah. Hence, the Rush writes that it must be a Birkas Shevach V'Hodah. It's a Bracha of praise and thanks. It's not a Bracha of Asana Birkas HaMitzvah. And the Rambam, so it's clearly a fundamental machlokes, the Rambam and the Rush, on what is the nature of the Birkas Erisin. The Rush writes it's a Birkas Shevach V'Hodah, and the Rambam clearly writes it's a Birkas HaMitzvah. So it fits in L'shitaso, the Rambam who holds it's a Birkas HaMitzvah, so it goes with the general rule of making the brachas over L'asiyason, making the bracha first and then doing the mitzvah. But according to the Rush, it's a Birkas Shevach V'Hodah, so it's better to make the bracha afterwards. After the event happened, something happened, you know, you can't praise God before something happened. You have to wait till after it happened. So therefore, the Birkas Shevach, so it's a bracha on the institution of marriage in a positive way, and therefore you make the bracha after. So where does the Rabbi fit in? The Bishloma, the Rush, Birkas HaShevach, you make afterwards. The Rambam, Birkas HaMitzvah, you make before. But the Rabbi seems to say it's a Birkas HaMitzvah like the Rambam, yet he passes like the Rush that you make the bracha afterwards. So how do we explain the Shitas HaRabbi? Why, if it's a Birkas HaMitzvah, why wouldn't you make the bracha first? So, and at Tom, he explains, since it's dependent on someone else, the Kala has to accept. You can't marry someone against their will. If a woman refuses and doesn't want to marry you, and therefore the Kedushin is a no-go, it'll be a blessing in vain. And that's what the Ravid Shita is, that it's a Birkas HaMitzvah, but it's an exception to the rule because it's Toli B'das Acherim. That's the famous Shuvas HaRashba and others regarding the mitzvah of tzedakah. Why don't we make a bracha on the mitzvah of tzedakah? So we don't make a bracha on the mitzvah of tzedakah because Shema, perhaps the Ani will not accept it, and it'll be a blessing in vain. So the Ravid seems to say similarly there. Similarly, the only thing we'll have to explain is, but by Kedushin, you make the bracha afterwards. By tzedakah, you don't make the bracha afterwards. So therefore, you have to come on. There are other reasons why you don't make a bracha on tzedakah. If this is the only reason, it would come out according to the Ravid, that one should make, if the only issue was the Ani not accepting, so then you should make the bracha on tzedakah after. Apparently, there's more going on. And there are other reasons given why there's no bracha on tzedakah, one being that you don't make a bracha on something which they discuss if a person, the machshava, commits a tzedakah. So the discussion, maybe you're obligated in the tzedakah even though you didn't actually verbalize it. So if that's true, so it falls into the Beis Yosef's concept, why don't we make a bracha on bitul chametz? A bitul chametz, nullifying the chametz is biblical, bedika is only drabanan, why are we making a bracha on the bedika, not the bitul? So The Beis Yosef is right, because bitu b'leiv sagi. Since you can fulfill bitu in your heart alone, so Chazal never instituted brachas on mitzvahs that are to be done b'leiv, done in your heart. We need clear demarcation. Either way, that's the Ravid shita. So a fact, so it's a machokes, Ramam and Ravid, whether you make, everyone agrees it's a berakas a mitzvah, but whether you make the berakas a mitzvah afterwards. The Ravid says, kedushin is an exception to the rule. So someone to bring a raya to the Rambam shita, the Magid Mishnah over there in Perakim Mohil Chazisha quotes from the Ramban, he wants to bring a proof of the Rambam that Berakas errs and goes before. Why? Based on the Gemara Amsach and Av Zayin Amabez, that the Gemara says, the Chola Mitzvah Mavarach Over Lasiyas, and all the mitzvahs you make Over Lasiyas, and you first make the bracha, then you do the mitzvah. Chutz Min HaTzvila Levad, except for Tzvila. So if that's true, Shema Amina, we learn the Kedusha Mavarach Kodem. So therefore, someone to bring a raya for the Rambam. However, others want to point out, no, I think Rabbi Kiva Eger mentions it, that the Gemara is just saying Chutz Mitzvila, because that's Davka Achara, so that's an example where it's only possible to do it afterwards. You can't make the bracha before you become Jewish. So therefore, you must make the bracha after the tefila. And I feel a bit the evilo yata. And therefore, even if you made the bracha first, it's a no-go, because they call them mikudim dizman shibirach ohave bar mitzvah. You weren't shayach mitzvahs. V'lo shayach loma v'tzivano v'kulo beirach kal, and therefore you'd have to go and make another bracha. If a ger made the bracha before pashas, it's a no-go, and you'd have to make the bracha over again. So the Gemara is just giving me an example where you have to make the bracha. Masha'in came, when it comes to Berakas Erisin, the Ravid's just saying, L'chadchila ein mevarchim kodem ha-kedushin. B'kol makam shita, the b'di'evin in Berak kodem Erisin, moda ha-Ravid the yatz of eino chozer mevarach. V'mishum hachi naka rak tzvila, the b'zeh brachu davka achar siyasin, v'garagar abav siyasin. That's what someone is saying, no, that the Ravid, that's an interesting point, that according to Rabbi Kiva Eger, others that, let's say according to the Ravid, I made the bracha first, so would I have to make the bracha? So they're saying no. Which we're just thinking aloud, which would raise the question, so according to those shitas, the only reason you don't make a bracha is because the Ani might not accept. So we don't make the bracha afterwards. But based on that alone, so therefore, if you made the bracha before and they did accept it, so according to that shita, then maybe the Yevit would be okay as well. So either way, both the Rambam and Ravid have their own proofs from the Gemara. And in fact, the Meiri writes in Pesachim, and after Zayin Amabez, that the Yerushalmi brings a Gersa Chutz Min HaErisin, not Chutz Min HaTzvila VeErisin. It's not just Tzvila. And therefore, and therefore you get into this machok is Rambam. Either ways, we have three shitas. We have the Rush that says it's a bircha shevach, and therefore you make the bracha afterwards, and therefore in theory anyone can make the bracha. According to the Rambam, it's a bircha samitzvah, you make the bracha first, and therefore the chassan should be the one making the bracha. Today, the Masada Kedushin does it, not to mevayesh, not to embarrass those who can't make a bracha, like by a Baal Koryak, we have by Kriyas HaTorah. And the Ravid is a discussion, what is the Shita to Ravid? Whether some say the Ravid holds, like the Rambam, it's fundamentally a Berachas HaMitzvah. If we don't make it afterwards because of, we make it afterwards, we want to make sure the woman says yes. Or, and then we said, or someone is maybe he holds like the Rush, it's a Birka Shabbat Valdah. But he's saying, you know, but either way, whichever way you go, so when the Gemara says Chutz, so I'm going to bring a Raya for the Rambam, the Gemara only says Chutz Minat Tfilah. If Kedushin was an exception, you would, you'd also put chutz min hatzvila b'kedushin? Let's say it's no raya, no. Because tefillah is only good if it's done before. Only if the bracha is done after. But if it's done before, you have to repeat it. Well, in the case of kedushin, the raya would be moda. And the question is, what is this tefillah bracha birchas ha-mitzvah? Is there a mitzvah of geiris? So that's part, you know, that gets into the whole discussion of what is the nature of birchas erisin. Is it birchas ha-mitzvah or birchas shavah gadol? The two major nafkaminas is who's chayiv in the bracha, the chasen or anyone. And today, anyway, we don't, the chasen doesn't make it because of not the mevayeh, but he should be drinking from the wine. That's it, it's a chumrah of the briskets, they have the rabbi, the Masada Kedushin, also drinks in the wine. And then the major issue, when you make the bracha, we pass in like the Rambam, we make the bracha before the Kedushin. And actually, throughout, say, the Bereshis, we know, Maisa Avo Simul Labanim, as the Ramban tells us, that we learn from the actions of our forefathers, and that's also separate in the Nevuah, but on a more pragmatic, basic level, follow Avram around for a day and you learn how to become a mensch. We learn the Midah of Chesed. The different Avos have known for different Midahs. Of course, they all had all the Midahs, but the emphasis of the Avos were different Midahs. So we know Avram is known as the Midah Chesed, and as the parasha begins, he's involved in the mitzvah of Hachnasas Archem. And he even realized how important Hachnasas Archem is. He was in the middle of talking to God, and all of a sudden, three people, actually three angels, but to Avram, he didn't know they were angels, they appeared, and in the middle of talking to God, because God came to visit Avram for Bikur Cholim, he left and he took care of the angels. And we learn, Gedola Hachnasas Archem Mikabalas Pnei Hashchina. We learn out, the Gemara in Shabbos learns out from here, from the event with Avram and God, greater is the mitzvah of Hachnasas Archem than it is Kabbalas Pnei Hashchina. Of course, the kasha is, how did Avram know that? We learn out from Avram Avinu. It seems a little chutzpahdik that he would figure it out on his own, like God, just a couple of Arabs on the road are more important than God. So how did Avram know it? So I heard a pshat from Rav Nissen Alpert. God taught it to him. I learned it from God, but we don't see in the Chumash God telling him, so how do we know? So he explains, because we know Nevuas Moshe Rabbeinu is different than all the other Nevi'im. Moshe Rabbeinu is the Avah Nevi'im, and he was able to speak to God panim al panim on a higher level. All the other Nevi'im, it came in a less clear, they were in a dream, they were spaced out, they weren't all there when they got to Nevuah. So Avram was used to talking to God, but it was a totally different experience. All of a sudden, when he's in the middle of speaking to God, it's been a blackout, no power, etc. The power has been down. All of a sudden, in the middle of talking to God, he sees a picture of three people coming his way. So Avram was nobody's fool. He says, why is God showing me these people? He must be teaching me that Gedola Hachnasas Archem Mikabalas Pnei Hashchina. So we learn, so the Gemara learns it out from Avram. Avram learned it out from HaKadosh Baruch Hu himself. So if we go, so we continue in the parasha and we see how well Avram takes care of the guests. He Vayar, Vayarat, he sees them and he runs, and it's a double language of Vayar, and we all have it. For instance, what's the double language of Vayar in the Pasuk? So Lamasha, let's say Friday night, Vayar, we see some people who might need a place to eat, some aniyim, but okay, then we just go back and have a nice meal. But Vayar, and then the second Vayar is the light bulb went on, like, what are these? If there's people I hear, I have an opportunity for Hachnasas Archem. And the real Hachnasas Archem is inviting people who actually don't have any food, don't have a place to eat. Many communities, and it's a nice custom, you invite me this Shabbos, I'll come to you next week, and that's all great for other reasons. But in terms of Hachnasas Archem, the Iker Hachnasas Archem are people who actually need the food, etc. So we see throughout Avram and Sarah are very involved in the mitzvah of Hachnasas Archem. However, there's one strange pasuk there. It says, "Yukachna ma'at mayim." Avram says to get the Torah says to get, he only got a little bit of water. So the question is, why is Avram so stingy with the water? If we see from everything else, Kohamar Bareza Meshubach, he's going full force ahead. and he's doing everything. He's getting the steaks ready, the potatoes, the fries, the ribs, the shawarma, the whole works. And all of a sudden, with the water, he's very cheap on the water. What's going on here? So I have heard a pshat from the name of the Chafetz Chaim, and I heard a pshat from Rav Nissen Alpert. So we'll do the Chafetz Chaim first. The Chafetz Chaim says, and I actually heard the Chafetz Chaim from Rav Alpert, but the Chafetz Chaim says as follows. He says there are two dinim in of guests. Of when you invite guests, there's a din of kabdehu, to honor them. And then there's another halacha of a chashteyo. You can't be naive. As we said, you're taking people off the street. Poor people you don't know, aniyim, so you don't know their criminal record. So you can't be naive. If you're hiring someone to work by the cash register, you can't just take someone who was arrested for geneva. You have to use seichel as well. So of course, if some people say, before I invite them, let me get the FBI report, the CIA, am I having anyone into... So some people are very big on the chashteyo. But Avram Avinu was very big on the kabdeyo. When it came to kabdeyo, anam, I guess, the meat, the potatoes, the works, then he went all out. He brought the best of foods. But as Chazal tell us, during the day of Avram, they used to worship the earth on the ground. So what do you mean, mayim? He wanted them to wash their feet. So just in case they're Ovdei Avodah Zarah, I don't know if they are or not, but just in case they're Ovdei Avodah Zarah, here's a little bit of water. So when it came to Kabdeu, honoring them, Avram went all out. When it came to Chashteu, okay, a little bit of water. That's one pshat. However, Rav Nissen Alpert suggested another pshat. That wouldn't mean Yukach Nam Ma'ayim, because as Rashi and Chazal tell us, who got the water? So it says Ayidei Shliach. So again, the different Chazals that's why it was criticism that, or we'll see if it was a criticism, but it was because the man got directly from God because Avram gave the bread, but because he sent the shliach, so therefore they had to come through the rock. Moshe didn't have to actually hit the rock. So we see, you know, the Musa Haskel is obviously the more you put into an action, the more you're going to get out of it. But we'll see the way Rav Alpert's explaining wasn't necessarily a negative, but in terms of is there's no gas in the car, you know, you can't run. It's a natural consequence. And unfortunately, many people in New York know that there's no gas around to put in the car. So it's just a natural, it's not a punishment. If you do something directly, your impact is going to be great. If you do it more indirectly, you're going to have less of an impact. So Avram's impact was so great, the man came directly. It wasn't necessarily a punishment, but since he didn't do it directly, so therefore they had to get the man through a shliach as well. So what's the pshat here? So it wasn't like today, you open up the faucets and you pour out the water. It used to be wells back in my day when we had the wells, and we had to go walk certain miles to get the wells. We had to bring out big barrels, and we had to schlep the barrels. And to the effort, as Chazal tell us, he sent his messenger, a shliach, different opinions who it was, Ayidei Shliach. So Avram's telling us a tremendous yisod in chesed. When do people become tzaddikim? At someone else's expense. You know what? Why don't there's someone coming in at 3 a.m. in the morning, I can't make it, I think you should go and pick them up. Or why don't you go ahead and go to the store, and why don't you go... When it comes to telling someone else to do, you notice people become tzaddikim. But the trick of Avram Avinu was the opposite. When someone else is doing it, you know what? Well, if I was going to get the water, I'm sure Avram would have brought the three barrels of water. It would have been harbe mayim, just like the ribs and the potatoes. But if you're telling someone else to do something for you, then you do the minimum, not the maximum. And that's what Avram's telling us the midas achesed is, as Rav Yisrael Salanter is famous for saying, what's the definition of a tzaddik? The definition of a tzaddik is you worry about your own ruchnius and someone else's gashmius. You know, people are tzaddikim. I know a lot of tzaddikim are worried about other people's ruchnias. They don't really care so much about the other people's gashmias. But Avram, and obviously, and you knew the lesson that if he's doing it himself, then kol kavod. But if I'm doing it for someone else, if someone else is doing it for me, I'm not going to take on all the chumras now and make sure, okay, so the bare minimum, let me, whatever water we need for the meal. So they'll have one cup of water instead of six or two cups. But if I was doing it, then I have a right to go ahead. But to tell someone else, and that's what, in fact, we see this before by Avram, by Tengli HaRachush,
that when Avram, after the war, so he didn't want to take any of the booty from the war. But he said, I don't want people saying, you know what? People are going to say, they're making the God didn't make me rich, but you made me rich. Avimelech, etc. So, of course, the Mefarshim point out, however, that was only for himself. But for the other soldiers who fought the war, of course they're deserving it. Against the real Alpi Hadin Alach is, when you win the war, the possession is yours. So if I want to be Machmer on myself, I'm not going to take the booty. That's because I don't want people saying that someone else besides God made Avram wealthy. But it's not for me to take the chumra on you. Anyone else, you deserve it. And therefore, you could take whichever, you know, you could take all the booty you want. So we see Avram knew the secret of chesed, that when you're involved in the mitzvah of chesed, that's the time to go all out. And of course, we see as well Avram and Sarah, because Ishto Kagufo. But obviously, Avram and Sarah were one, and therefore, if Avram and Sarah were doing it, so therefore you go ahead and you could do it all together. But if you're telling someone else to do a chesed for you, now's not the time to become a tzaddik. And therefore, that's what we see, the two lessons of chesed. When we go through all the parashas now, all the different lessons we learn of the mitzvah of chesed. So on one hand, we learn from the Chafetz Chaim's Yisod that we should focus on the kabdeo. Of course, you have to do, don't be naive. You have to do a little checking, but ultimately you should err on the side of kabdeo. And Rav Alpert's Yisod of don't be a tzaddik at someone else's expense. The time to be a tzaddik is when you're doing. That was the message of Avram. And also, as well, the other message we learned is that the Jews received the man directly, but the water they only got Ayyidei Shriach. So therefore, and we see what were the results. The results were that the man got directly and the water indirectly, because we see that's just the Yisod in life. Not limited to Chesed, whereas in Ruchnius, Gashmius, the more you put it, the more you put in the way that the Bria is set up, the more you put your effort into something, the more you're going to get out of it. The Gemara talks about, even though my wife disagrees, but that the food tastes better when you yourself make it, you know, as opposed to, because while the effort, I definitely think my ribs are better than anyone else's, but I'm saying is, because the more effort you put into something, that's just an extension of that you sowed. And that's why, and that's what we see from the incident with the mud and the water later on. So we'll have to continue learning through Sefer Bereshis. It's a Torah Chaim, and it's not just we learn many halachas, even though we don't learn halachas Kodama and Torah. So I should say there are many midos we learn, many attitudes we learn from the Avos, the Imos, Yosef, etc. And that's what many of the stories in Sefer Bereshis, as Rashi tells us in the beginning of Bereshis, why begin with Bereshis? Why not get straight to the mitzvahs? Because the purpose of the Torah is to do the mitzvahs, because koach ma'is of higiliyamo, that before you have the mitzvahs, you have to know your potential. You have to know what you're capable of doing. We learn through the stories, we see how great you could become. You could become an Avram Avinu, a Yitzchak, a Sarah, a Rivka. On the other hand, you could become a Sodom and Amorah. You could become an Esav. So the potential's there, and therefore we have to learn the parashas carefully and Bereshis, you know, and learn through the parasha and learn how to become a mensch.
Parashas Chaye Sarah, Perek Chav Dalet, Pasuk Sama Gimel. The Torah tells us, Vayetze Yitzchak Asuak Basodel of Nozerev. The Torah tells us that Yitzchak went out, and the Gemara in Brachis, and Daf Chavav Amid Beis, says this is the source for Tfilas Mincha, that Yitzchak was going out to Daven Mincha. So we'll discuss a little bit about Tfilah in general, and then focus on Mincha. So the Rambam writes in Hilchos Melachim, Perek Tes, Halacha Aleph, Ba Avram, who is Spalo Shacharis? We know Avram instituted Shacharis, or Idavin Shacharis. The Yitzchak Hifrish Meiser, Yitzchak took off Meiser, the Hosef Tfilah Acharis of Nozom, and he added another Tfilah. The Yaakov Hosef Gid HaNashev is Spalo Arvis, and Yaakov added Gid HaNasha and Idavin Meirev. Uvapash is Mulur Midvarev. So from the simple reading here of the Rambam, and it's based on the Gemara in Brachas Daf Chavav, So Yitzchak tikein tefilas mincha. Yitzchak instituted tefilas mincha. V'zeh k'rabbi Yosi bar Chanina the Sfira lay tefilas avos tiknun. V'tanya kavas of Yitzchak. V'tanya kavas Yitzchak tikein tefilas mincha. Rabbi Shua ben Levi pog sham the tefilas egad tamidim. So the Rabbi seems to be working with the opinion that the avos instituted tefila. Avraham shacharis. Yitzchak, Mincha, and Yaakov, Ma'ariv. However, in Hilchis Tvila, he seems to go the other route. In Hilchis Tvila, Perek Aleph, Halacha Hei, Kosef She Tvilas Keneged Temidin Tiknun, that the Tvila we daven, Shacharis and Mincha, correspond to the sacrifices brought in the temple. V'zeh l'shono, and this is the language of the Rambam. V'chein tiknu sheh minyan ha-tfilos to minyan ha-karbonos. That the minyan of tfilos to minyan ha-karbonos shtei tfilos b'chol yom k'neged shnei t'midin. That the shachar se mincha corresponds to the tamid shel shachar with the tamid shel ben ha-arbayim. V'tfilah hi k'neged tamid shel boker hi ha-nikras tfilos. That's our tefillah we call shacharis, u'tefillah k'shekeneged tamid shel ben arbayim hi nikras tefillas mincha. So we see that from here, from the Rambam and Hilchos Malachim, he seems to go with the first pshat, that the Yitzchak instituted tefillas mincha, and from the Rambam and Hilchos tefillah, he seems to say tefillah k'neged karbanos. And to the Maritz Chias in Brachas wants to interrupt the Shaila by saying, Sha'af Shatikin Yitzchak Tfilas Mincha. It really was Yitzchak who instituted Tfilas Mincha. Mikol Makam, Adu Mechayuvim Kain, Rak Mishim Takhanes Chazal. It's true, Yitzchak was the first one to daven Mincha. Perhaps there's another medrash that says really Adam, Harisha was, when he was praying for rain. But Adu Mechayuvim Rak. And he wants to go over a famous Rambam in the Perish HaMishnayis in Chulin, who points out as follows. He wants to tell you a Yisod Godo. Shakol Ma'ashan on this Harav Imenu, O Osin Oso Hayom, anything we do today, or anything we're required to do today, Ain anu osim zos elo v'nesivay Hashem alidei Moshe. It's only because God commanded it to Moshe. Lo v'nesha Hashem ziva bekach l'neviyam shekadmo. Not because it was given to Avraham, Yitzchak, and Yaakov and any of the previous neviyam. Ain anu ochem Avraham menachai. Lo v'nesha yasa al b'nei Noach Avraham menachai. Elo v'nesha Moshe asar lav Avraham menachai v'vashnitztava b'sinai. It's only because Moshe was given the prohibition in Har Sinai. V'chein anu mo'im b'glal she'avram, we don't do mila because of Avram. Elo b'nei she'Hashem sival yidei Moshe limo k'moshe mal Avram alav ha'sholam. V'chein gira'na she'in anu nimshakam achar isi Yaakov avinu elo tibay Moshe Rabbeinu. That's the famous Rambam, Yisod Gadol. The only mitzvahs we are obligated in were those we were given on Sinai. Things given to our avos are not, might be nice, and we might learn some ethical teachings, some attitudes, but we are in command. I don't have to do milah because of Avram. If it was just given to Avram, I didn't have to do milah today. I wouldn't have to keep Kiddush Nasha. And therefore, Kasav Maritz Chiyas, Shekein Yoshko, you could say the same shot here. Even though Yitzchak instituted Tfilas Mincha, anu mechayovim bazer rak mishem shetiknu chazal neged temidin. It's true that Yitzchak did daven mincha, but that's not the reason why I daven mincha. We daven mincha because Chazal told us, or it depends. Depends on the machlokas Rambam or Ramban on whether tefillah is daraisa drabbanon. If it's daraisa, then it's because it was given Har Sinai. If it's drabbanon, because Chazal told us. And therefore, And that's Achini, and therefore Dafka Indian Mitzvah Hashem, Shemachayev Alzano Zerach Mam and Har Sinai. And that's the pshat over here in to the Rambam. So the Rambam, when he's giving me the history in Hilchos Malachim, so it's true Yitzchak Daven Mincha. But in Hilchos Tfila, when he's giving me the halachas of davening, we're davening because it's connected karbonos. And in fact, really, there are two aspects to Tfila. There's the aspect of the Tfila Kavua, the one from Anshei Knesset Hagadola. They instituted the 19 blessings, the Shmon Etzer we have today. And then there's the second part of Tfila, our own personal Bakashas. In other words, there's a famous Mesha Chachma in Parshas Vayechi, where the Torah tells us, I think it's dealing over there with Yaakov and Shechem, says, Bisalusi Uba'usi. So the Targum interprets Bisalusi Uba'usi, different types of prayer. Or the Torah says, Bacharbi Uba'kashti. The Torah says, with the sword and bow and arrow, and the Targum says, Bisalusi Uba'usi. So what forced the Targum usually translate the literal translation? What forced the Targum here to go with the other translation? So obviously it's not the pshuta, because when you're fighting a war, first you use the sword, first you use the bow and arrow, and then when you get close, you arm to arm combat, then you take out the sword. But here the Torah tells us the sword first, so clearly it's not talking about the war. So the Targum interprets it to tefila. There are different types of tefila. There's a tefila of a sword, and there's a tefila of a bow and arrow. What's the difference between a sword and a bow and arrow? So a charbi, a sword, a nice good one, a nice sharp one, a little nick of the neck and that person's dead. You don't have to do much effort. The sword speaks for itself, so to speak. But for a bow and arrow, it all depends how much you pull back, how much power you put into it, how much energy you put into it. The more you pull back, the more you put into it, the more you get out of it. So those are the two types of prayer. The Gemara says Tfilas Avos Tiknun and Tfila Keneged Karbanos. So the Tfila Keneged Karbanos, you bring the same karban every day. Chazal instituted a certain format for Tfila. We daven, we have the Shmon Esrei, we have the Shevach section, the praise section, the Bakasha section, the request section, and the thank you section. And you have those sections, and on Shabbos and Yantiv, you have to deal with the Kedushas Hayom. But it's a fixed format. It's Kavua. So it's a fixed format, Kavua. So we go ahead and we pray. That's the formal tefillah. But then the Avos, Avraham, Yitzchak, Yaakov, they all were under different situations, and they sprayed more spontaneously based on their needs. So there's a second aspect of tefillah, tefillah keneged avos, that's much more personal. You ask your own personal bakashas. And getting back to the Mesha Chachman, that's a whole discussion that, let's say you don't understand Hebrew, should you daven in a different language like English? So there's a whole discussion, you know, that today you have Hebrew-English Siddurim, but the Nakuda is the Mesha Chachman, based on the Mesha Chachman, that if you're going to daven in Hebrew, so even if you don't have that much kavana, it's still going to be powerful, because Chazal were in tune to what they asked for. So by merely reading those words with kavana will be a lot more powerful. But just merely reading the words of tefillah, that by itself is like a sword. It has a lot of strength in its own right without much effort. When you're going to ask for your own personal bakashas, you need your own effort, and therefore it makes sense, because most people, when they're asking for what things they personally have more kavana anyway. So that's a discussion in terms of what language, but if you daven in Hebrew and understand it, that's even a greater ma'ila. So that's what they point down here, the different aspects of tefillah that Tefillah keneged avos and Tefillah keneged karbanos. And this too, this mentioned something specifically on Mincha. So the Gemara in Brachas Daf Chavav has a machokas to sov zman Mincha. When is the last time I can daven Mincha? So Rabbi Yehuda says until Plag HaMincha, and the Chachamim say until Chatzos. So the question is, how do we paskin? So Plag HaMincha, what is Plag HaMincha? Plag HaMincha is, let's say, on the 6th to 6th day, 12 hours. So 4:45 would be Plag HaMincha. So according to Rabbi Yehuda, the last time to daven Mincha would be 4:45. 4:46 you could daven Ma'ariv. And according to the Chachamim, Mincha goes until sunset. At nightfall, then you could daven Ma'ariv. So the Gemara says, who do we paskin like? The Gemara says, Avid Kamar, Avid Kamar. The Gemara doesn't come out who we paskin like. So what is the halacha? So therefore, the post can point down, you have a choice. However, you have to be consistent. You can't take a half of Rabbi Yehuda and a half of the Chacham. In other words, if you daven Mincha after Plag HaMincha, so you're clearly showing the Chachamim. So you can't daven Mincha then, you can't daven Ma'ariv before sunset, because then it's a tarte desastre that you are going ahead and you're davening Mincha during this time zone, it's screaming at its daytime. You daven Ma'ariv, it's screaming nighttime, you can't have the same tefillah in the same time zone. Similarly, if you daven, according to Rabbi Yehuda, if you daven Mincha before Plag, that's okay, and Ma'ariv after. Of course, you'll have to repeat Kriya Shema. That's a separate halacha, v'shavka v'chamecha. That will have to be repeated regardless. But in terms of this davening Ma'ariv, because Tzviyas Arav is Rishus, so A medaktin l'zmana, we're not so medaktik in terms of the Zman. According to Chachamim, l'chatzchila, you should daven Mincha before Shkia, and Ma'ariv after. After says, but minimally after Shkia, that's the discussion in the first Tosfos in Brachas, Tabez, Amin Aleph. If you could avoid the Tarte Desastre, the question comes up Friday night a lot, especially during the summer months, when you have a set time for Mincha and Ma'ariv, and then you end up doing this Tarte Desastre. So that's a discussion among the poskim. What's your best option? So obviously, the best option, if you get it early Mincha, it's a non issue. Let's say you can't, so is it better to daven b'tzibor tarte desasre? Is it better to daven this one of a mincha and then daven ma'ariv later? So some point out that even though all week long, let's say, it'd be a tarte desasre, perhaps Friday night is different. Why is Friday night different? Well, we know Friday night's different for many reasons. Why is it different regarding the tarte desasre? That's what the Aruch HaShulchan quotes from others and other achronim, that when Shabbos comes in, when we daven Tefillas Ma'ariv, so perhaps that makes it like L'machar, that makes it like the next day already, it becomes Shabbos, and therefore it's considered the next day. So there's, so even if you're not going to rely on Tarte Desastre in a Tziba during the week, then there's more to rely on regarding Shabbos. That Friday night, that when the tzibur, you don't have an option, so you have another sniff to rely on, that Friday night's different, because when you daven Shabbos, it's considered nighttime, and therefore it's considered in two different time periods, and it's not considered a tarte desastre. Parshas Chaye Sarah begins, ironically, with the death of Sarah. And we also find that at the end of Sefer Bereshis, Parshas Vayechi, Vayechi Yaakov, is really the death of Yaakov. And the rabbis teach us, Tzadikim b'misasam nikra chayim. Righteous people, even after their death, are considered living, because as long as the message remains, therefore we can continue learning from them. In fact, that's the famous medrash and the parable they give, that really it says King Solomon, Shlomo HaMelech says, better is the day of death than the day of birth. So a strange statement by any means. We usually associate death with bitterness, anger, confusion, and birth is excitement, laughter. So what is in the world does Shlomo HaMelech mean? Better is the day of death than the day of birth, the day you're born. And our rabbis explain with a mashal, a parable. There were two philosophers at the seashore watching as one cruise, one boat was about to launch off. And all the family and the friends were coming before. They had their tailgate party. They were having a great time. And another ship was about to come back, maybe 60 years, 70 years, and when one philosopher said to the other, how foolish these people are. They're celebrating the wrong ship. This ship hasn't even left the port. Who knows what's going to happen tomorrow? Accident, crash, pirates. It might be over tomorrow, next week. This ship, after 60, 70, 80, 90 years, 100 years coming back, that's the ship we should be celebrating. And that's what we do. We celebrate the life of someone. You celebrate the life of someone after they're no longer with us, because in this world you get a chance to have all your accomplishments, to do things. You're in the next world, you just reap the benefits. And that's why it says the righteous people, even after the death, are considered living, because you learn Rashi, you learn the Rambam, or any of these people, your parents, family, friends, had an impact on you, and that remains forever. In fact, we say during our davening on Rosh Hashanah, Yom Kippur, we say, Sifrei Chayim v'Sifrei Mesim Pesuchim. We open up the books of the living every year, and the books of the dead. So Bishlom are books of the living, I understand. You lived the whole year. We have to go over and see, go through your year. How was it? Good, not so good, okay. But someone who's been dead for 20 years, nothing's happened. So what do you mean every year you have to open up? So that's what they explain. Is, let's say, I'll give you a mashal. Let's say, Rav Aaron Cutler, one of the great Rabbanim, Gedolim, who brought Torah to America. So he opened up a small little yeshiva in Lakewood, New Jersey, which is now the biggest yeshiva, I think, in the world, even bigger than Panovich, maybe 5,000, I'm not sure the numbers. But from that Lakewood, besides Lakewood, New Jersey, they branched out, they're in Eretz Yisrael, they're all throughout America, Europe, Canada. So every day, every year, Rav Aaron Cutler gets the reward, not only for the schar that he got for the yeshiva when he was there, but even afterwards. And that's what it means, tzaddikim v'misasa nikra chayim v'yu chayei sara. And in fact, we know we have a custom to put a monument up after someone dies. Look at different minhagim. The old minhag Rabbi Kivega brings down was after 12 months, when you begin to forget, because the Gemara tells us in Brachas, you be after Yud Beis Chodesh, you begin to forget. You know, of course, we always remember on a certain level, and therefore, when you're about to forget your loved one, you put up the monument, and therefore to remember again. So what we do, we have a, usually now we do it within the first year. Some do it right after Shiva. So one of the customs is we put a rock on top of the monument. What's that all about? Why do we put a rock on top of the monument? So historically speaking, it made sense, because we didn't have the big boulders, these big machinery, the caterpillars, the deer, we could move all that stuff. They used to take a bunch of little stones and pile them up. And they were buried out in the middle of a field, so to prevent animals from trying to dig in, so every time you went back to visit the grave, you put more rocks on, in order to keep it going. So that was one reason given, that's the historical reason, but today obviously that reason doesn't apply, we have the big stone, the big monument, so why is it today that we put on? So what does the rock represent? So on one level, the Hebrew word for rock, Sur, also means HaKadosh Baruch Hu. And therefore we say this person isn't alone. That God, the person's never alone, even though he passed away, he might be alone in the grave, but God is always watching. And the rock, in fact, that was a whole major discussion when they were writing, I think, in not Tikva, but a Declaration of Independence, whatever it's called, and they were discussing in 48 whether to put God's name or not. So obviously the religious Jews said put God's name, and the secular Jews said, what does God have to do with anything? We're not going to put God's name in. So they came up with a compromise using the word Sur. They put rock in. So for a religious person, we know rock means HaKadosh Baruch Hu. For someone else, it can mean something else. So either way, so what an explanation of Sur is that God's always watching over, the person is never alone. Another explanation is that a rock is permanent. A rock is forever. So too, you say that person's legacy, that person who, your loved one, whoever it may be, his influence will be forever. Even though he's buried now and it could be many years, but today I wouldn't be that type of person without him. I wouldn't be a mensch, I wouldn't be a talmid chacham, I wouldn't be in techesed, whatever the different things you learn from that person, so that impact remains forever. Like we know an act might only be temporary, like the Gemara says in the beginning of Shabbos, what a poor person does for the rich is greater than what the rich does for the poor. The rich gives to the poor, they give them food, they give them money, and I'm not downplaying it, it's a great mitzvah, they have food for a couple of days. But the fulfillment of the mitzvah of tzedakah, of chesed, that impact is forever. That plays a role in your neshama and impact every mitzvah you do, and therefore it's even a greater benefit. So that's what the Torah is telling us here. By you Chayei Sarah, and the life of Chayei Sarah was 127 years, that she lived life to the fullest. And therefore, that's why it says regarding Avraham, but it's true about Sarah as well, the Avram Zakein Baba Yamim. Avram was whole coming in his days. So Chazal interprets to mean is that every day Avram lived to his fullest. Every day, every opportunity he had to do good deeds, to do mitzvahs, he took advantage of. And therefore, he lived life to the fullest. And Sarah as well. As we know, he didn't, not a moment wasted. Like imagine you see someone on a bus, every 5 minutes throws out a $10 bill. So basically showing a contempt for money. You're not going to give that person money. We even have a colloquial expression in North America, let's kill some time. You know, let's waste some time, let's kill some time. That's exactly what one's doing. You're killing life. Life is full of tremendous opportunity and mitzvahs. As the Vilna Gaon used to say, but I think he used to cry before, like I have to make sure I get all my mitzvahs in now, because once I pass away, it's all over. To put on a beged of tzitzis, it's so easy. And I can get all the reward doing all these mitzvahs now, but you have to do them now, and you won't necessarily get the same opportunity later. So that's what the Torah is coming to tell us, to praise the tzaddikim, Yaakov, Sarah, that they live life to the fullest. And now, if you want to learn from Sarah Imenu, now's the time. Obviously, you can learn during the lifetime as well, as we do learn during the lifetime of Gedolim, but you don't get the full impact until later on. That's why the Mefarshim point out by Moshe, it wasn't until later on where it says they talk about the punishment or they realize the potential. Because the crime against when Paro the Egyptians were killing the babies, putting them in the Nile, taking them out of the Nile, killing the babies. Okay, so that's you destroyed a bundle of potential. But now what you see after 120 years of Moshe Rabbeinu did, Eved Hashem, So therefore, it's a totally different level. And that's what the Chazal and our rabbis tell us, and that's the message here, that tzadikim b'misasam nikra chayim. Of course, during your lifetime, kavod abrios, you have to treat them properly and learn. But even acha misa, the nikra chayim, we have to continue learning from their wonderful ways.